Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Better Late Than Never. Understand, Survive and Thrive, Midlife ADHD Diagnosis. By Emma Mahony. Foreword by Sari Solden. Narrated by Polly Lee. The Story of Fidgety Philip. Let me see if Philip can be a little gentleman. Let me see if he is able to sit still for once at table. Thus Papa bade Phil behave, and Mama looked very grave. But Fidgety Phil, he won't sit still. He wriggles and giggles, and then, I declare, swings backwards and forwards and tilts up his chair. Just like any rocking horse, Philip, I am getting cross. See the naughty, restless child growing still more rude and wild till his chair falls over quite. Philip screams with all his might, catches at the cloth, but then that makes matters worse again. Down upon the ground they fall, glasses, plates, knives, forks and all. How Mama did fret and frown when she saw them tumbling down, and Papa made such a face. Philip is in sad disgrace. Excerpt from The Story of Fidgety Philip from the book Struwelpeter by Dr. Heinrich Hoffmann, published in Germany in 1845. This poem appeared alongside the first published treatise on ADHD in the British medical journal The Lancet in 1904. Foreword. Better Late Than Never takes the reader on an exciting and informative journey of self-discovery, from understanding the condition to learning to thrive with late diagnosis ADHD. It is an intimate tour of the inner world of women who have lived with both the struggles and the strengths of undiagnosed, untreated ADHD. Transparent, honest, and personal, this book goes beyond a mere dry presentation of facts. Emma Mahony beautifully weaves expert facts and contributions into her personal narrative. Through this detailed description of her life and journey with undiagnosed ADHD, from confusion to diagnosis to medication and therapy, we follow Emma as she ultimately comes to know and understand herself. Having been a therapist for women with ADHD for over 30 years, I can attest to the fact that most women with ADHD symptoms at midlife seem to want to be fixed. Their low sense of self-worth has led them to be isolated from others and alienated from themselves. The small daily assaults to one's sense of self when living with unexplained and untreated ADHD until midlife is untethering and overwhelming. They are determined to put off any moves toward a meaningful life until their difficulties are gone. They do not feel entitled to pursue personal goals or take power in relationships. They have idealized gender role expectations and have internalized a negative self-view that ignores their positive traits or strengths. They are focused almost entirely on what's wrong with them. They want to run from that part of themselves by hiding, withdrawing, pretending, and retreating. Women are very often not diagnosed until midlife, as this book clearly explains. Often, they do not have stereotypical symptoms, or these symptoms have been masked by learned compensations, depression, or a high IQ. They grow up without a soothing, internalized voice, and with no explanation for their difficulties. Because of this, their core sense of self easily gets tangled up with their brain-based differences, and their self-esteem suffers. These women compare themselves to neurotypical women and often feel like failures as women, wives, mothers, friends, and co-workers because their executive functioning struggles make daily life a battle. Knowing no different, it's natural to assume that everyone is combating the same issues as they are, but doing so more effectively. Due to all of this, women who are not diagnosed until midlife are in need of healing, of being steered towards acceptance and wholeness and away from shame and self-blame. This is the goal of counselling for these women, as is discussed in length in this book. It's a subject that's often left out of books on ADHD. Emma's takeaway message to the reader is critical. The key to living successfully with ADHD as a woman diagnosed at midlife is not to try to get over who you are or to engage in an exhaustive and defeating battle to fit in, but instead to find a good fit by channeling your traits. The true goal for an adult with ADHD, and this is what my life's professional work has centred on, has to be to try and teach people not to keep trying to get over who they are. Rather than hoping to be fixed, I encourage them to see themselves as whole, with difficulties and strengths, as a person with deep values and core traits that define them, ultimately, much more than their ADHD traits do. Emma's journey is the perfect vehicle for this lesson. Through her humour and insight, she can continuously widen her horizon by taking in possibilities and options that will bring her greater satisfaction. This is the ultimate lesson in the book: to turn discouragement into hope and give the reader the belief in the possibility of moving from surviving to thriving, despite their diagnosis. Getting to the point where one can start to believe this is possible is the first and most important step in a journey to wholeness and healing. Emma Mahony is a great ADHD role model. Demonstrating through her courage to persist despite her struggles, that with the right support, we can use our natural desire to innovate and create, to make meaningful contributions and lead fulfilling lives. Sari Solden's Women with Attention Deficit Disorder was written in 1995, updated in 2005, and has often been described as a book that saved my life. Female readers claim to recognize themselves within it and no longer feel alone after a lifetime of secretly hiding their challenges. Her second book, Journeys Through ADD Adulthood, Walker and Company, first published in 2002 and was released in 2020 as an audiobook. Solden has spoken at over 100 national and international conferences, as well as maintaining a private practice in Ann Arbor, Michigan in the US. Her latest publication, a self-help workbook called A Radical Guide for Women with ADHD, Embrace Neurodiversity, Live Boldly, and Break Through Barriers, was co-authored with Dr. Michelle Frank, and tells the story of women who have shown up in their practices over the years and aims to overcome negative self-talk, discover strengths, build meaningful relationships, and resist cultural stigma. SariSolden.com. By Sari Solden, MS, therapist, speaker, and author of Women with Attention Deficit Disorder. 10 Things to Know About ADHD. 1. It was first described as minimal brain dysfunction, then hyperkinetic disorder. In 2004, it became ADD, attention deficit disorder, and now is generally termed ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. 2. Its three traits are impulsivity, restlessness, and distractibility. 3. Many successful entrepreneurs, comedians, actors, sportsmen, artists, and musicians have ADHD, including entrepreneur Richard Branson, comedian Rory Bremner, actors Johnny Depp, Channing Tatum, and Emma Watson, Olympian Michael Phelps, racing driver Lewis Hamilton, and musician Will.i.am. 4. It is a neurodevelopmental disorder, not a behavioural one. This rules out the theory that it is down to poor parenting, too much TV, junk food, and other myths. 5. It is similar in heritability to height. Around 80% of cases are inherited from one or both parents. 6. It affects 3 to 8% of the population, regardless of gender or race. However, boys are 3 times more likely to be diagnosed than girls. 90% of children or teens with it experience classroom behavioural or emotional problems, peer relationship problems in school, low academic attainment, school suspensions, or expulsions. 7. If left undiagnosed and untreated, it can develop into more serious oppositional defiant disorder, ODD, or conduct disorder. 8. People with ADHD have lower levels of the brain chemical dopamine, which regulates movement and attention and is linked to addiction. ADHD does not affect intelligence. 9. Around 20% of the prison population suffers from undiagnosed ADHD, according to a study by the UK Adult ADHD Network. 10. Unlike other neurodevelopmental conditions such as autism, ADHD can be safely treated with medication and diet, exercise, and lifestyle changes. Preface. Diary entry, 17th January 2016. Yesterday, I was diagnosed with ADHD. It was a long time coming, 51 years to be precise, and the diagnosis was remarkably swift when it came. The process was painful as sitting in the dentist's chair, and the information that the psychiatrist needed to extract was not sugar-coated or balanced with the positives. It was bald and bare-faced, and the responses had to be black and white. It was a long interview, an hour and a half, but that's not long to sum up a life, especially if you are going to change that life with a diagnosis at the end of it. Dr. Jane had pages and pages of questions to ask, and he wanted me to be very precise with my answers. The answers I could use were often, very often, seldom, or not at all. But sometimes the questions didn't quite fit. And yet, if he seemed robotic in his quick-fire approach and batted away any attempts from me to pin him down on the meaning of the words, he never seemed to be reading from a script. It was like the questions were a knife to pierce through my carapace of half a century to get me before I had time to think of or sculpt answers. He wanted the questions answered impulsively, intuitively, before I could reflect. Either that, or he was in a tearing hurry to get on to the next person. The result of that day and that diagnosis is this book. Introduction. Fall down 7 times, stand up 8. Japanese proverb. This book is about late diagnosis of ADHD in an adult, anyone over 18, but more specifically about late diagnosis of ADHD in women, an area that has been much less researched and somewhat overlooked. This complex issue tackles mental health and is written for anyone who has ever struggled with their brain and felt shame at being unable to function like others, or who may see clearly that a loved one has all the traits of ADHD and wants to know what to do. If you are picking this book up as a medical practitioner, hungry for a deeper personal understanding of how ADHD can affect patients, particularly female ones, you will find plenty of honest accounts of the mashups within my life and truth in the detail of how the traits have affected it. My personal story, interwoven with all the science and references to medical studies, focuses only where the ADHD has shown up in my life, so may seem a little heavy on the disaster stories at times. My story. Because of the way my brain is wired, I can't help but get things wrong. Even at the age of one, when I learnt to speak, I would say everything backwards. Butter was tubber, birds were dubbies, and it took a while for my parents to transpose the letters and see that I was making sense. The merest trifles that most people do naturally, arriving to places on time, remembering their wallet, not losing things such as keys, mobile phones and credit cards constantly, paying fines, avoiding speeding tickets, etc., are rather boring things at which to excel in my world. I've made them that way so as not to beat myself up when I fail at them regularly. However, the older I get, the more I realise that these boring things are actually important, and how exasperating it is for people when they think that I do them on purpose, or, more recently since my diagnosis, that I use ADHD as an excuse. ADHD is not a moral failing. It is a neurological one. It is not all in your head, and there's no subconscious intention to forget something, as one therapist continually suggested before diagnosis. It is just that I am neuroatypical. One of my earliest school memories is of combing the grass around my walk to school in search of an exercise book that held all my homework. I'd lost it somewhere, somehow, and I was genuinely scared as I traced and retraced the steps along my daily journey. I knew that my headmistress might beat me with a horse-riding crop across the back of my legs for losing it, because I'd been beaten before by her for seemingly smaller trifles, such as mucking around in the lunch queue, bored. I was 7 years old. What I didn't know then is that not even her beatings would stop me from losing things. I've never been able to learn that particular lesson. Only yesterday, 45 years later, I was retracing my steps along a 6-mile dog walk, this time trying to find a credit card that had dropped out of my pocket. I lose things constantly, and was practicing non-attachment to things before I could even spell Buddhism. As a young girl, I was a tomboy. From around the age of 7, I refused to leave the house if my mother made me wear a skirt, and I was more likely to be roller skating or riding down the road with my arms folded on my bicycle than playing with dolls. Being a tomboy gave me an excuse to engage in more physical and risky activities, such as climbing trees and jumping off rocks into rivers. I had 2 brothers. And quickly learnt that girls seemed to have a really boring hand dealt to them in the days of Barbie does the ironing. It appears my experience was more typical than I knew. Psychotherapist and author of Women with Attention Deficit Disorder, Sari Solden, comments, "The problem for women is that most of them were not diagnosed as children. Even if they were hyperactive, they usually did not act out in the same way boys did. They were apt to be labelled tomboys or written off in some other way without understanding the underlying attention deficit disorder. Like some people, you may wonder if ADHD is actually real. A few years ago, a book called ADHD Does Not Exist was published to great critical acclaim. The author, A behavioral neurologist argued that ADHD described a cluster of symptoms that were also present in 20 other conditions, from bipolar to giftedness and depression, and didn't exist as a separate disorder. The timing of this book chimed with fears of an ADHD epidemic in the media and a statistical rise in offering young children medication, with anxiety around medicalizing childhood and playing into the hands of Big Pharma. Many of the traits were put down to bad parenting, like the time when my father suggested that what my ADHD son Michael really needed was a jolly good thumping. And who can't point the finger at any mother or father and find them wanting? So, when I hear of today's fears around a rising diagnosis of ADHD in children or adults, usually tapping into worries around taking medication, my response is different than most. I feel thankful. Rising diagnoses mean that this invisible condition is at last being brought into the light. And with that recognition will, hopefully, come understanding and compassion. Because, to quote from the Eeyore of experts on the condition, the author of more than 19 books on the subject, Dr. Russell Barkley, this is a very serious disorder. As adults, people with ADHD are 5 times more likely to speed and 3 times more likely to have their licenses revoked than other people. They're more likely to experience accidental injuries, burns, poisoning, traffic accidents, and all kinds of trauma than other people. In fact, having ADHD makes you 3 times more likely to be dead by the age of 45. Yikes! I'm bloody lucky to be alive. So, in this book, I'll expose why I believe it's a condition whose time has come. Why I am thankful that the approach to disciplining children has changed dramatically in a single generation, so that my son, who was first diagnosed with ADHD aged 12 in the last year of primary school, won't have to suffer the indignity of being put over someone's lap and caned, as his mother was. This was the headmistress's last resort in our small private school, despite her being fond of me. And, believe it or not, I also used to argue in favour of corporal punishment in school debating lessons because it was over and done with quickly, and I preferred that approach to the hours I spent facing the wall outside of the classroom, counting the bumps on the wallpaper. It was so boring being excluded from the class. When asked at the 2014 International Conference on ADHD what the overriding sense of having the condition is like, the motivational speaker and author of Movers, Dreamers and Risk Takers, Kevin Roberts, said, "It is like having a giant foam finger pointing at my forehead saying, 'You are wrong.'" It is true. Few children with ADHD will emerge from school without a battering to their confidence. I learned about being ashamed of my shortcomings from an early age and quickly invented ways of covering them up. I used to memorize joke books because I saw how quickly humor could diffuse a situation. Charm, complimenting teachers on their dress sense, sometimes worked, as did effusive politeness in the face of being caught or found out. And yet, underneath this bluff lurked a sense of shame. And shame is a dangerous emotion. It carries with it the whiff of something unclean, not quite right, something to hide, not to show others, and still does today. Shame is a lonely feeling. It is suffused with a sense of unworthiness of love, of somehow not fitting in or being good enough. Recently, I went to a memorial service of a university friend who struggled with his mental health all of his life, despite holding down an impressive job in the city. That he decided to take his own life, without telling a soul, making plans with friends and family just the day before and with a full contacts book and calendar, spoke to me about the power of shame. Rather than reveal the extent of his loneliness or struggles, he chose to overdose on his medication. A church service packed with his friends, colleagues, and family who'd given up their work time to be there on a Monday afternoon showed just how easily he could have reached out instead. Shame can be a killer, and shame's little sister anxiety also needs watching. It is impossible to lose or forget things or let others down constantly without being affected. Underneath the humour and charm that I worked at so hard to cover up the deficiencies, there was a puzzling lack of trust in myself that could manifest as a lack of confidence at unexpected moments. It didn't seem to fit with my outgoing, extroverted personality. The ADHD might have been masked by chutzpah and an expensive education, but I lived in constant fear of being exposed in some way or other. I was a personality riddle to others and myself, seemingly bright, yet always letting myself down. It is also a miracle that I haven't had more brushes with the law, given the statistics around this disorder. Perhaps it was deliberate that I was attracted to a criminal barrister for my husband. If all else failed, I knew he might be useful in court. Now, still married after 25 years, and with 3 adult children of our own, I tell him to get his own dinner party disaster stories and stop telling mine. Like many ADHD diagnoses that come in middle age, commonly out of their child's diagnosis, mine was the beginning of an understanding into why I'd often caused mayhem around me, and usually walked away pointing the finger at others. As a journalist who had worked on national newspapers here in the UK, the more I looked into this complex condition with my research hat on, the more I understood why I was so well suited to my job of deadlines and an ever-changing roster of stories to work on. I also understood why I was attracted to certain friends, some of whom have had complicated and difficult lives, although only 2 have a formal diagnosis, both after a long struggle with a misdiagnosis for bipolar disorder and medication that didn't work. You can imagine how annoying the 3 traits of ADHD, impulsivity, restlessness, and distractibility, are at an early age. My parents tell me they had complaints from the neighbours in the flat below when I was still a baby in my cot because I used to fidget and make the cot squeak. A difference, not a deficit. For all the underachievement, knocked self-esteem, and cost to society that accompanies this disorder, remember the statistic that an estimated 20% of prisoners have undiagnosed ADHD, there is also a positive cage-rattling quality and creativity that comes with being wired differently. You see, for my son, and for me, to have ADHD is not lesser. It isn't even a serious impairment, it just is. And I am hopeful that the leaps that have happened towards acceptance of gay marriage in the Western world and curing HIV and AIDS, once called the gay plague, will also happen in my son's generation towards understanding and accepting neurodiversity. Soon, people with ADHD might be open about it at a job interview, something advised against on every online forum, like I did at mine when I decided to retrain as a secondary school teacher after my diagnosis. Soon after, I performed my own show on ADHD at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival because I felt driven to overcome the stigma, raise awareness, and open up the conversation around it. There is so much that can be done once you get a diagnosis to help you live well and understand the condition, that I wanted to be involved in educating others around it too. The theme of the 2016 ADHD Awareness Month in the US was Knowing is Better. While tabloid newspapers continue to rail against the rising number of diagnoses, I firmly believe that knowledge is power. Diagnosis is a double-edged sword in middle age. It brings with it grief and regret for what might have been, but ultimately it offers a responsibility to use the gifts and time we have left to be the change in the world that we want to see, to paraphrase Gandhi. There are so many pros to processing the world differently. There is no need to concentrate on the cons. Thriving, not striving. Nobody can emerge from a positive diagnosis as quite the same person. This book will show you the benefits of accepting ADHD in your life, how it will help you in multiple ways, from finding the courage to seek accommodations in your workplace, to parenting better, to having better relationships with your partner or friends, to knowing how to take care of yourself in a healthy way when the inevitable overwhelm descends. But I don't want to think of ADHD as something you have to endure, because I believe deep down that ADHDers have more to contribute to the world than some box-ticking neurotypicals would have us believe. We thrive in situations that others abhor, such as crises. We think outside of the box. We have an energy, if our interest is piqued, that means that we go the extra mile to find an answer or discover a cure. I wouldn't be surprised if the coronavirus vaccine is discovered by someone who comes out later as an ADHDer, pulling his or her second all-nighter in the laboratory when all others have gone home exhausted. In a state of hyper-focus, we can smash Olympic records, and the fact that award-winning racing drivers, artists, musicians, actors, comedians, inventors, and scientists have this brain proves that it can sometimes be a brilliant, not a bad thing. But first, you have to realize that diversity doesn't only apply to race or gender, and that neurodiversity is equally worthy of positive attention to overcome the shame that surrounds any whiff of mental health difference. Ultimately, this book is about hope, about someone who never really understood herself very well until she had a diagnosis and then found that it was a liberation from a lifetime of covering up and blaming others for her misfortunes. Now, I leap into situations others would spend a lifetime avoiding simply because I know how to work. I welcome the chaos sometimes because I am comfortable with it, just as I equally crave structure and order. How to use this book? This book is divided into three parts. Part 1 helps you understand this highly complex neurodevelopmental disorder. Part 2 explains how to survive with it in a neurotypical world. Part 3 helps you thrive with the knowledge that you are wired differently brain-wise. I hope you, the reader, find the answers you are looking for in this book, or at the very least, are entertained by my account of a life blundering around in the dark until I found the light switch. This is a serious condition, but my approach is somewhat light-hearted. I can't help it. The one thing that has been my biggest saviour has always been humour. So forgive me if I trip lightly over some of the heavier aspects sometimes. 10 of the most common things lost in the UK annually. I have always wondered about the disproportionate amount of time I spend looking for my glasses in order to find the other thing I have lost, and how that adds up over the years. Recently, Privilege Insurance carried out a survey of how long people in the UK spent looking for things they have lost, and found that people spend 6.5 days of their life searching just for the remote control for the TV. This led me to wonder what the figure might be for someone with ADHD. Here are the top 10 most commonly misplaced items in the UK. 1. Remote controls. 2. Glasses. 3. Keys. 4. Mobile phone chargers. 5. Socks and underwear. 6. Pens. 7. Wallets or purses. 8. Headphones. 9. Shoes. 10. Bank cards. Part 1. Understanding ADHD. Chapter 1. What ADHD is and is not. Knowing is better. Slogan for ADHD Awareness Week 2016. So, what is Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, or ADHD? Firstly, it's a misnomer, a poorly phrased description, a seemingly catch-all acronym that inaccurately describes an inability to regulate emotion, interest, and attention as a deficit. It's described as a hyperactivity disorder, even though one of the three presentations includes a form that is inattentive only. Before 1987, it was known as attention deficit disorder, and the inattentive form is still sometimes referred to as that. However, with or without the hyperactivity, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder is the current description we are stuck with, so I'll use it for the purposes of this book. When describing what it is and how the three traits of restlessness, distractibility, and impulsivity play out, particularly in an adult's life, it is helpful to understand what ADHD is not. Pseudo-ADHD. Most people think that everyone is a bit ADHD, that our culture is increasingly making us that way as pre-verbal children and pre-care home adults spend much of their waking time looking at big and small screens, rushing around being busy. If aliens landed on planet Earth tomorrow and hung around on our transport system to see how our society functioned, they'd see millions of Earthlings jabbing their fingers at their smartphones or their faces illuminated like miniature blue moons in front of their laptops, barely noticing their green-headed neighbour, unless they had ADHD and spotted them on the far platform. My family is no different to the rest of the nation. A typical scene might be my ADHD son playing Xbox, "Turn that sound down!" against some other teenager in Japan, while my elder son watches a movie on his smartphone. How can he bear the teensy size of the screen? With earphones in, my daughter uploading photos onto Instagram, my husband answering work emails on his phone, while I try to get their attention to sit at the table for dinner. This scene is what psychiatrist and ADHD specialist Dr. Ned Halliwell calls pseudo-ADD, because despite the fact that it might look like scattered attention, mind-wandering, and a lack of concentration, it is nothing to do with ADHD. So pseudo-ADHD is all around us and deemed acceptable in our Western culture. From the mobile phone that interrupts and demands answering when we are having an intimate dinner with an old friend, to the expectation of school children to have their phones on them at all times, vibrating in their pockets. "We are all ADHD now," comes the rallying cry from the Daily Mail leader writers. The ADHD tidal wave, with its increasing diagnoses year on year, is just an excuse for bad parenting, or laziness and lack of discipline in kids, isn't it? While many people may be temporarily silenced by the fascination of what is on their mobile, when the charge finally drains out and they are forced to find something else to do, drift off to read a book, fix that broken fence, attend to bills or mow the lawn, that's when the ADHD becomes evident What the ADHD person will be left with is a restlessness. The butterfly brain that finds it harder than the rest to settle down to that homework that needs doing, ADHD child, or that tax return that is 2 years overdue, ADHD adult, and will allow, instead, a mounting anxiety to begin to gnaw away in the pit of the stomach, often closely followed by a negative internal chatter of, why can't I get my act together? What's wrong with me? Why does everyone else seem to manage? Eventually, such negative self-talk either motivates adults with ADHD into action because they can't bear it any longer, or they carry on procrastinating in front of a card game on their computer, or distract themselves with self-medication, alcohol or marijuana to relax, more caffeine, a stimulant to help focus, or cigarettes, sex, video gaming, porn, running, anything that will take the edge off the constant mental restlessness and sometimes physical restlessness that accompanies this condition, and has done all their life. And that is the point. Someone who is neuroatypical and has ADHD has not developed pseudo-ADHD as a result of living in our caffeine-fueled, restless, 24-hour, always-on-call, high-octane Western culture, or because he or she has just purchased the latest iPhone. This has always been their way of operating. Go figure. The estimated 7% of children and 3% of adults who have ADHD may reach their 30s, 40s, 50s, or even 60s and think, how come I am the only person at the dinner table pouring another glass of wine when everyone else wants to go to bed? Or, how come I am the only person I know who brings a wrap of cocaine, marijuana joint, to parties when everyone else seems to have grown out of that habit? What's wrong with everybody? The ADHD-er might ask. I was surprised to learn, early on in my diagnosis, that adults with ADHD have poor self-regard, so we may have a tendency to think the world is wrong, and only we are right. A sort of me-against-the-world tendency, which is also a curious form of self-preservation that keeps the ADHD-er battling on regardless. Despite the odds, swimming against the current, thinking it is everyone else and not them. Is it me, or is it ADHD? I have a theory that people will always justify the way they behave, however badly it might seem to others. So even convicts in jail, a number of whom I've interviewed for newspaper articles, will have made sense of their crimes in their head. If you have ever spoken to the two sides of a divorced couple, they each have perfectly valid reasons for why their marriage failed, and usually it has nothing to do with their own failings and everything to do with their partner's. People make up stories to make sense of their lives, and usually their versions are sweeter than the real truth. I mention this because, at this stage of the book, you might be thinking, what has this woman got that I haven't got? Isn't ADHD just a giant excuse for the things I struggle with? We all have difficulties keeping our kids on track at school, doing the boring but necessary jobs in life, reducing the washing pile to less than a mountain, as one Spanish au pair called it, looking after our wallets, keys, bags. The difference is we don't write a book about it or talk about complicated acronyms as a disorder. We so-called normal people just deal with it. This is most people's take, and it is the problem that ADHDers, especially women, come up against, despite the condition being around for 100 years, backed by hundreds of thousands of medical studies and big pharma companies inventing expensive medication to reduce its effects. And the mountain of washing is just the start of it. Because, as psychotherapist Sari Solden says in her book, Women with Attention Deficit Disorder, What happens to a woman with ADHD is that a disproportionate amount of her time is spent finding things that she just put down somewhere and has now lost. Corralling the piles of disorder around the house is a mountain in itself, to be climbed daily. Add to that a sense of time that doesn't seem to chime with others, what clinical psychologist Russell Barkley describes as a blindness to past, future, and time more generally, as well as an inability to direct behaviour toward the future and sustain it. And suddenly, you have a recipe for a day that can unravel quickly. Of course, there are ways around this. E.g., keys with giant keychains have to go into the key bowl immediately. But remember, most adults with ADHD are undiagnosed, so attempt to operate like everyone else and beat themselves up when they can't. Like physically disabled people who want to use the normal changing rooms at the swimming pool to avoid the stigma, people with ADHD believe they should be able to keep hold of their bag like everyone else, so shouldn't need a special routine or giant yellow tote to do so. With this thinking, sometimes the house can become a sort of prison, a prison that I avoid by sitting in my car and putting off the moment when I have to go in and face the overwhelming avalanche of boring tasks that present themselves on my way up to my study. I think of the artist Louise Bourgeois' sculpture Femme Maison, literally housewife, where the woman is pinned down with a house covering her face. It's hard to leave when there are so many unfinished tasks to do, and you've lost your keys again anyway. Would it surprise you to learn that we have never locked our house in the countryside in 10 years, unless going on holiday, because it is easier than getting new keys cut regularly or being locked out? Sari Sulden describes this overwhelm as the key feature of adult female ADHD, a woman who spends so long on routine tasks that she often doesn't have time for the work or creative outlets that sustain her. Sulden places disorganization as the key feature that pushes the ADHD adult to the brink. As subsequent chapters will show, addiction or depression, for example, can often be what therapists call a presenting symptom. It might be the reason you seek help for something, only to learn down the line that perhaps ADHD is the underlying itch that is causing the scratchiness. So the pseudo-ADHD that is all around us is not helping the confusion around understanding exactly what this complex disorder is. While it provides a good mask for the ADHD-er to allow them to fit right in with others, it is something totally different to having the neurodevelopmental difference all your life. One of the first things a good ADHD psychiatrist will do is to screen out reasons why the patient may feel they have it, whether that's a recent bereavement, divorce, drug addiction, or depression, or the purchase of a new Xbox. What's in a nickname? What's in a nickname? A lot. Nicknames, the cruel childhood tags given to you by family, friends, or even enemies, can be a curiously useful starting point when weeding out pseudo-ADHD.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.